As you may or may not be aware, I started getting into the Doctor Who Online community around 2013. One consistent thing people have been complaining about since then was Matt Smith's second season, that being Series 6 of the revived series. Now, people have calmed down about it for numerous reasons.
Partly due to the quality of the following three seasons being considered much, much worse by some, and I guess the three after that by others.
It could be that the people who watched it around the time discovered that much worse Doctor Who had existed prior. It could just be to do with most of us aging, as these things become less and less important to us.
Either because we find the mishaps of that season trivial, or we became the minority of people who think,
"Eh, woman bad, the show now panders to the woke SJW leftists, yeah."
But I never forgot this season, and I never forgot what people thought about it at the time. But then, there was a point where I started thinking about the positive side of things, thinking that the season may be better than what people laid on. I do like seeing the good side of the show whenever possible. The bad is sometimes hard to overlook, though. But when I had those thoughts, I started to think maybe people were judging this season too harshly. I remember just how good some of the episodes were and how terrific the cast were, as well as the interesting concepts this season generally deals with in its arc. So in this video, I'm gonna go through the season as a whole, every aspect of it, give or take supplementary material. So no Christmas or charity specials. Every episode, the characters, the arc overall, even how the mid-series break affected the season. So sit back, relax, and enjoy as I revisit Series 6 of Doctor Who. Before I begin, I am just gonna give a little warning. This video is gonna be filled with a lot of opinions, possibly ones you don't share with me. All I ask is for you to be civil. And if you want to start a discussion in the comments, go ahead as long as you're civil and it's about the season. So yeah, keyword opinion. So let's dive in. Episode 1s have the hardest job at the best of times. They have to hook people in at the start of the season, and sometimes have to sell the show not just to new audiences, but to returning viewers as well.
Series 6 arguably had a harder task than Series 5. I'm not saying the 11th Hour didn't have a difficult task, far from it. Not only did it have to establish a new style, but a new Doctor, a Doctor who wasn't David Tennant, as well as two new companions, one more than the other, and the series arc as a whole, tasks which I think it succeeds at.
The Impossible Astronaut at least matches it, in my opinion. Luckily, long-time viewers will mostly be on board, as Moffat's style already had a season to marinate with some people. The main cast of the season also comprised of characters that we have already gotten to know.
What this episode had to do, however, was set a series arc more interwoven than any previous one, except season 23, but that was 25 years prior, and no one watched it, so there's that. It also had to be as big as a finale, which was risky. More on that point when I get to Day of the Moon. This season was also gonna be the big push for mainstream success in America, so if this episode failed to capture the American audience, it failed at its job.
So there was a lot riding on the Impossible Astronaut. Does it live up to expectations?
Now, objectively, yes, as the entire season got an average of over 7 million viewers at the time. Yes, there was a drop of about 1.5 million after the first episode, but episode 1s usually get a sizable amount more than later episodes, just as a finale gets a sizable amount less. Doctor Who is also popular in America to this day. Sure, it always had a hardcore fan base, but it also has a consistent casual fan base too.
But does it do everything else right? Well, I would say so. Sure, everything that's set up is quite obvious in retrospect. You know what all the twists of the season will be. But it does set up the arc well, and the story as a whole.
The integration of America is done well here, not portraying too many stereotypes. The moon landing is a genius setting for a Doctor Who story as well. Not just tying into the American push, but it's just also an interesting time in history to explore. Speaking of interesting, the silence.
In a way, they're similar to Moffat's earlier creation, the Weeping Angels, due to the fact they do something funky when you look away from them. But instead of moving and either sending you back in time or possibly even killing you, the silence make you forget they even existed. I guess you could say they're silent, but deadly. All of the characters are great.
We are introduced to Canton Everett Delaware III, who is one of the more memorable one-off characters in the revival. It's also interesting to see President Nixon play a role in the plot.
More on him in Day of the Moon. All of the regulars pull out the stops here too.
The mystery of said astronaut and the little girl tied with it is also interesting.
But again, more on that in Day of the Moon.
Although the cliffhanger seemed messy, that feeling mostly should come from the delivery.
As knowing what's happening with Amy in the season makes all this make sense. Overall, cracking first episode, 9 out of 10. In a way, this episode still had a lot hinging on it. Episode 2s are important, but this one is the second part of a two-part opener. It needs to succeed. Also worth mentioning, throughout the whole of the revival of Doctor Who, second parts typically don't live up to the first part. So is it good? Yes, very. It doesn't answer everything, but that's the job for the rest of the season to do.
But it does resolve the plot about what the Silents are doing on Earth in 1969. Their concept is ran beautifully as everyone forgets, but has to figure out a way to remember them. The episode also starts with a fake-out for some reason, but then course corrects. They investigate the Silence, meddle with Apollo 11, and try to save Amy, who's been kidnapped.
The characters continue to be great, as always in the case of the regulars, and especially Nixon?
Legit, whenever he enters a room, like, a stereotypical American piece of music plays, and it's the funniest shit. Wish they played more on him being a terrible person, rather than just a homophobic comment.
Everyone is written as well as they were before, and the standout of the main cast here, in my opinion, is Rory. But there is good acting all around.
But Canton using a gun is a bit much of a stereotype.
How they defeat the Silence is a bit strange.
It is clever using their own tactic against them, as well as using subtle uses of time travel to their advantage, but is no one going to talk about a post-Time War Doctor committing another genocide?
Other than that, the continuing of the threads was done well.
Especially the effective use of the little girl regenerating, which acts as a powerful cliffhanger.
Aside from my gripes, which does mark it down, this is as solid as the first episode. 8 out of 10.
So this is the first one where I worry.
This episode is pretty much the season's filler, so not too important in the grand scheme of things. But due to wanting to keep the new audience, this episode still has to be enjoyable.
Speaking of the audience, a pirate-themed episode makes a lot of sense, as it does stick to British roots, while also appealing to American audiences, as Pirates of the Caribbean is popular and there is a movie coming out at that point.
The reason why I worry is because the last time I saw this, it was meh. Not amazing, not terrible, just there. This is a common opinion amongst the fandom as well. So have my views changed? A little.
Sure, this doesn't quite evoke Pirates of the Caribbean, but it does stick to Doctor Who's guns of being a base under siege. The sci-fi element to the pseudo-historical is mainly inspired by pirate folklore, which I find to be clever. Also, Hugh Bonneville as Captain Avery is superb and bounces off the Doctor beautifully, captain to captain. Rory does take a step back, but essentially he's the damsel that Amy has to protect. Speaking of Amy, I like how proactive she is.
Being essentially the action hero role, companions such as Ian, Stephen, and Ben were in the 60s. This also emphasizes the unique dynamic between Amy and Rory, as their traditional gender roles are switched, which isn't just showcased in smaller scenes while they're talking, but big sweeping statements like we've seen earlier. But let us discuss the smaller scenes in the episode.
I mentioned earlier about scenes between the Doctor and Henry, but there are also scenes between the captain's son, Toby, and some of the crew.
All of these small moments are handled well and they make the story worthwhile in my Other than that, the story doesn't really offer much. I don't like the siren!
Okay, she's fine writing-wise, but it's all the post-production that just doesn't look good.
Like, I know she's a hologram and everything, but she doesn't look like she interacts with the environment. Like, light does not work that way. Also, the plot seems to go too fast towards the start and the end. The middle is mostly made up of smaller scenes that take up most of the runtime, but the plot does seem to want to rush the start so we can get to the middle, and once it realizes it took too much time in the middle, it just ramps up at the end. When the plot does move in the second act, it also feels like each twist happens one after the other.
Also, the Doctor, although brilliantly played by Matt Smith as always, seems to come to his conclusions too quickly.
Well, yes, these assumptions are wrong. He's making them based on what he sees immediately, or just makes up stuff that happens to be right. Sure, the Doctor's smart, but clearly not that smart because he gets things wrong constantly in this episode. Like, yeah, he can get things wrong and show that, but for this episode, you sort of don't believe the trust between Captain Avery and the Doctor here. So the story had problems, but it was still enjoyable. If you skipped it, I don't blame you, but if you didn't, fair enough as well. But if you didn't, that's fair too. 6 out of 10.
Neil Gaiman!
Yeah, this isn't just one that was hyped a lot beforehand, but is commonly considered one of the best episodes in Matt Smith's entire run of Doctor Who. This is because Neil fucking Gaiman wrote this.
However, the next season does prove that Gaiman plus Doctor Who does not necessarily equal good, so would I say The Doctor's Wife is deserving of fan praise?
Well, what if I told you that I would consider this among the classics such as Genesis of the Daleks? Would that answer your question? Yeah, this was probably better than what everyone is expecting, and what everyone currently thinks of it, but I wouldn't call it underrated. This is honestly an idea that gives a modern context to something Doctor Who has established for many years, ever since the 60s even. And isn't that what New Who tries to do anyway? Basically give a modern context to the classic ideas of the old show? Now, does this mean I'm calling The Doctor's Wife a definitive New Who story? I mean, yes, that is literally pretty much what I just said there. It isn't my favourite one of the revival, but it's up there, and is a contender for my favourite Smith story. But why am I giving this so much praise? Mainly the concept alone. So you know how the TARDIS has been continually referred to as a living thing all throughout Doctor Who?
Yeah, Neil Gaiman decided to make a character piece on the TARDIS by giving her a human form so she can express herself to the Doctor and the audience as a whole. The dynamic between the Doctor and the TARDIS in this episode is honestly breathtaking to behold. Matt Smith and Saran Jones do an excellent job of portraying both characters.
Their dialogue is almost perfect too, as the TARDIS would of course be written in a temporally confused way. And yes, what both the Doctor and the TARDIS say to each other does seem a bit pretentious sometimes. It's that right level where I don't give a shit. The reason why I say almost is because...
I think you call me... sexy.
I think it would have been more impactful if old girl was said instead, as that's what the Doctor calls her more. And heck, that is said several times even within this episode. This is just a nitpick, so you can ignore it if you want.
Amy and Rory scenes are really great too, with House, the main villain of the piece, voiced brilliantly by Michael Sheen, toys with them, and makes them suffer. These scenes are chilling and almost get into our heads as much as Amy's.
Speaking of House, brilliant villain concept.
A sentient asteroid from another universe who feeds on TARDISes. That's cool and unique, and complements this story beautifully. The set and costume designs are great too, almost looking like a really good Tim Burton film. The ending is too brilliant, wrapping up the chemistry between Smith and Jones, continuing the arc of the season subtly and in a way which makes sense for the story, as well as showcasing that the TARDIS is still very much alive without a human body.
My only criticism of the scene is the dubbing of House. Sheen's dialogue doesn't really have much time to breathe. Again, just a nitpick. Overall, honestly one of the best Doctor Who stories out there. Proof that Series 6 has a gem despite its reputation.
It was also cool to see an Ood again.
10 out of 10. So a bit of context for this one. Going in, what do you have to hype about?
I mean, it's a two-parter using the concept of doppelgangers, Nito Burrito. Now let's see who's writing this one. It's Matthew Graham.
So let me get this straight. The guy who wrote Fear Her, one of the most infamous stories of the RTD run, is coming back. Fear Her, guy. And you think it's a good idea to give him not just one episode, but two? Why? Okay, I gotta have faith. As much as Fear Her isn't good, it's still an episode that I enjoy, even though it's not for the right reasons. He also wrote the acclaimed sci-fi show, Life on Mars. So maybe this would be good, right?
Well, it's not bad. The first act wasn't clear until it was explained what the gangers were. They are a cool concept. They're essentially avatars. And this episode does the genius concept of making the avatars in the original humans desynced, while the flesh themselves still retain the memories of the originals. The problem is, some of the decisions in terms of execution, like the flashing in the mirror, were a bit weird and oh god, that thing away from me!
The character drama was good, with Rory being the standout here once again. He tries to understand what the flesh want, to live. He recognizes that despite whoever or whatever she is, she needs help. And she's in pain, and she's afraid. And his nurse instincts makes him want to look after her. This showcases why he's a great companion, and probably my favourite companion of the Matt Smith era. He even goes against what the Doctor wishes, because he's doing what he believes is right.
Human Cleaves is also a great foil, essentially being the one to go against what the Doctor says due to her power complex, as well as starting the war between the humans and the gangers that will be expanded upon in the next episode.
Although I feel this particular episode is underrated, there are still elements that irk me. Some parts aren't really written very well.
Mostly it's just one-off parts that seem a bit iffy.
Most of which I mentioned earlier, but it is a recurring problem. I'm gonna expand on this episode's issue with clarity. It's either clear, or usually not clear enough.
One of the best scenes of the episode is when both versions of Jimmy argue over which one of them is real, discussing the moment of his son's birth, but this happened after Ganger Jen had a similar scene with Rory.
The themes of hatred for the other are overt through the dialogue, but we don't get enough reason as to why Cleaves would be against, you know, equality between the flesh and the humans. Sure, fear of the unknown existed within all of the characters, but Cleaves resorted to murder. The other characters didn't do that. Overall, I would recommend giving this underrated episode a second chance. Maybe you'll like it this time, but it isn't perfect. I'll give it a 6 out of 10, as the writing and directing irked me a lot, and it happened often enough that I'm not comfortable with giving it anything higher. So this episode had quite a lot of setup that it needed to pay off. There isn't just a Ganger war going on, but there's a Ganger doctor walking about now, which is sure to give the second part an interesting dynamic. And all of the characters have such interesting morals and motives to play with. There is one problem, however. The writer and the director aren't off the hook. They are the reasons why this story isn't as good as it should be. Admittedly, it's director Julian Simpson over and writer Matthew Graham, so hopefully the actors and the premise can break the part 2 curse, right? Nope. Okay, I didn't think this episode was bad. It does at least wrap up everything it was setting up in a satisfying way.
Also, the themes are randomly carried on through Amy with the Ganger Doctor, which does conclude well, as their boots, which were the thing differentiating the two, were swapped.
Which either gives the message that everyone is equal, with no exceptions, or that Amy is a closeted bigot. It really depends on how you watch the episode. Speaking of the way gangers were handled, I'm disappointed. It's almost as if, the Ganger Doctor excluded, that the writer just forgot the gangers were the same people as the human counterparts.
There was one clever scene where he remembered, but that's about it. This was by far the most interesting thing about the rabble flesh, and the almost people did nothing with it.
Instead, focusing on the fact that the flesh, and by extension the gangers, are alive, and all life is precious and all that jazz. Yes, it's a good message, but story-wise it defeats the point of them being doppelgangers in the first place.
The example most prominent to me is the scene where Ganger Jimmy sees his son on the holographic call, which then spurs him on to having a change of heart and trying to save the non-gangers, particularly his human counterpart.
Which he fails to do the latter, but it leads to a good moment at the end, which I'll talk about later.
It is heavily implied that when he's cradling Human Jimmy, that Ganger Jimmy thinks that Human Jimmy is the one who deserved to see their son.
Why would he think this, though? Doesn't that defeat the point of him saying that Adam is his son too? He has no reason to change his mind, so that's not a good answer. But I'm not against what it spurred on.
The gangers changing their minds on the war. Regardless of what Ganger Jimmy's position on who's the real Jimmy is, the fact remains that he did it to be kind. Seeing his son inspired him to do the moral human thing, and the others followed because that's how they feel.
This is good, as it showcases that they aren't just merely copies, which showcases this episode's message beautifully. I still feel mixed about how they're being represented, though. However, them being identical in terms of looks is used effectively in the episode, well, on paper.
As Rory manages to deduce that one of the two gens was a copy, specifically to do with the lack of an acid burn. However, it is later revealed that both of them were gangers as the real gen died.
On paper, this is a great twist.
But I'd argue that it was undermined in the scene in between the two, where Gangor Jen gets Rory to activate the self-destruct, as we saw earlier in the story, that she wasn't able to as she wasn't human.
This undermines Rory's deduction skills, as in the literal previous scene, he is shown to be smarter than this. Because he doesn't question why she's getting him to do it, even though she's an employee. In fact, why does it accept Rory's handprint? He shouldn't even be on the register. So it only allows humans to authorize self-destruct, but it can allow all humans to self-destruct. Their security system is a joke. I've not got much to talk about other than continuing to mention how certain parts either don't work, or are mixed on a fundamental level. That's because other than what I mentioned, there's not really much to this episode. It's a paper-thin continuation of the cool premise that we got in the first episode. There is one more thing towards the end that I want to talk about, and that's the CGI version of Jen towards the end.
The CGI has been poor in this two-parter, especially the pile of discarded flesh. But the main thing people complain about in this whole two-parter is the creature Jen becomes at the end.
After discussing this with my boyfriend Ryan, who I've been seeing most of the season with, and giving it time to think about, I actually quite like it.
The issues of CGI in New Who is mostly the rendering techniques not aging well, but I can look past it if it looks real enough for the time, making the only real bad CGI being when the concept of a design is fundamentally terrible.
Monster Gen's design works in every level, I think. The rest of the CGI pertaining to the flesh does not, but I think it interacts with the shadows and the environment well. As for the design itself, people complain about it being unnecessarily grotesque. I'd argue that's the point, as this is Jen denying her humanity. So even though it came out of nowhere, I think it makes sense. Seriously, that whole point should have come up earlier. I might as well talk about the ending as well.
Gangor Jimmy gets to see his son and gets to live a normal life. And the remaining survivors, humans and Gangors alike, including human Cleaves, campaign for Gangor rights and demand more research into this technology.
I think this is an overall great conclusion to the story.
But then the arc has to kick in, where we find out the reason that they were there in the first place was so that the Doctor could study the flesh because he, for some reason, knew that Amy was one, which makes no sense. At least him knowing that she's pregnant makes somewhat sense due to the quantum status of her pregnancy. Then the Doctor doesn't make it clear to either of them until he literally murders Gangor Amy. Sure, she was being controlled by the real Amy, but this still pretty much undermines the entire point of the story.
I don't think we should blame Matthew Graham for this, as I think it was probably Stephen Moffat who integrated this into the arc. As it's not unprecedented for showrunners to use other writers' ideas later on in the season. I mean, look at how the Chameleon Arch was used in Utopia. This could have had a good ending, man. Overall, this story is mostly boring, and this episode doesn't help matters. The few parts which weren't boring were a mixed bag. I will say this story as a whole is better than Fear Her, as these episodes deal with ideas that are really good and runs with them. Even if what it runs with isn't the most interesting thing in the world. 5 out of 10. So, the stakes have been raised, Amy's been kidnapped, the Doctor and Rory have to battle their way to try and save her, achieving the Doctor's greatest victory but also his greatest defeat, as he has to face a threat greater than any he's seen before.
A TURF!
Yeah, we'll get to Madame Kavarian later. This is the show's mid-season finale, so in a way it has jobs similar in magnitude to the opener. It not only had to give a satisfying conclusion to the season up until this point, but also it has to have an interesting enough cliffhanger for viewers to return much later when we get to Let's Kill Hitler.
All I can say is commercially it succeeded, as the show continued to have strong viewing figures in the UK at least.
And as I said previously, the show is still a juggernaut in the US to this day. Critically, however, is a different matter entirely. Many people say how this episode's function was delivered in an unsatisfying way.
And the cliffhanger was so bland that they forgot either what it was or why they should care by Let's Kill Hitler.
Now, I will mention my own personal thoughts on these when I get to the section on the mid-series break. But what are my thoughts on this episode itself upon rewatch? Surprisingly, it's good! Sure, it starts off poorly in my opinion, and only really gets good when the Doctor shows up.
As there's logical inconsistencies such as the pre-title sequence with Rory and the Cybermen, wouldn't killing a bunch of Cybermen encourage them to make more?
And they use humans to make Cybermen. And Rory is the nearest human. You didn't really think that through, Doctor. Also, I don't really like how the Doctor hasn't recruited anyone notable we've met before.
Sure, there were the Silurians, and Dorian from last season, and Jadoon for about one shot. Yes, Captain Avery and his son show up for a scene, but the only notable characters are the newly introduced Paternoster gang.
If only Captain Jack appeared to lessen this complaint of mine. I get why he wasn't, but others should have joined.
Like Alonso from Voyage of the Damned.
Alonso would have been cool. Why didn't Moffat bring back Alonso? Hashtag justice for Alonso.
My last complaint about this opening is the...
With a thin, fat, gay, married Anglican Marines.
They have no point. Dorian already makes a line which jokes about stereotypes. We do not need these gays here only for one of them to be killed off. Anyways, the Doctor enters with style, but making the army of religious extremists military people, I guess, and the religious extremist monks who literally behead themselves, just massacre one another.
I like how the Doctor reacts to everything. Excuse me, why do people say Matt Smith can't do angry? He is doing it. I am registering it as anger. I don't see the problem here. Yes, it's out of character, but that is the point. The only way I can see this argument having any merit is that Matt Smith isn't used to this kind of acting. And to that, I say he isn't. Does that mean he did a bad job? No, he's good at acting. They cast him for a reason. Lee's feelings do feel like his own. I will say he does usually add character to most of the moments he has as the Doctor, but in this case he doesn't. But he still brings what's on the page to life. Also, I do like how this episode plays for the Doctor having this grand legacy. Because of course he has. Like, don't treat him like Space Jesus, but he has a legacy. He's been around enough places.
A lot would love him, hence River confirming the long-standing fan theory developed by Stephen Moffat himself of everyone getting the word Doctor from the Doctor. It also makes sense that a lot of people would hate him, hence the Church of the Papal Mainframe.
I like the Church of the Papal Mainframe. Don't know why, I just do. There's not much else to say. I mean, I like how it's written, I like how it looks, I like all the characters and how they're played.
Particularly Amy and Rory. They're amazing as usual, and it furthers the arc in a satisfying way. As for the River Tryst, more people should have seen it coming.
And I don't actually see why it's necessary. Yeah, I guess it both streamlines and complicates the overall storyline. But seriously? Was that it? All this time, the years we were waiting to figure out who River Song was, and she just ends up being Amy and Rory's daughter. I don't hate it, but it's anticlimactic. Overall, this was a good episode. Not amazing, but it did everything it needed to.
Also, rooms before rooms. Hashtag rooms before rooms. Hashtag justice for Alonso. 7 out of 10. So, seeing how this video is really long, I think I'll split it up into two parts. So, stay tuned for whenever part two of this video comes out. Hopefully it'll be out by Christmas. Remember to like, comment, subscribe, share, and all that. And yeah, see you guys then.